87 degrees, 22% humidity, 68-64 feet density altitude.
372 with a turnout. 712. We got a lot of bikes up here this year. A lot of bikes. This is a 750cc Triumph running in the altered vintage gas class. 1950 Triumph is the motorcycle. Tyler Malinky of Lowbrow Customs. He's the owner and the driver. 1950 Triumph vintage gas motorcycle. Holds the record in class at 126.455.
Motorcycle 712. Short.
Out over on the radio, I heard rider down.
Yeah, he's picking up the bike. He's actually, yeah.
Fuck.
Oh shit. You know, Tyler went down.
Oh fuck.
Just instantly terrified. I mean, he was in top gear, so he was moving, and you know, coming off a bike is never good, but you know, even with the safety gear and everything, like that's terrifying. It is my brother, you know, so it's even worse.
They won't let him anywhere near. They're like 20 yards away. Like the officials were like back off. But he says he was up and moving around, and it seems like he's okay.
Nobody in our team has ever gone down before. You know, we had some problems. Wheel slip, this, that. You know, I windowed the cases on a motor and locked up the rear wheel, but did not go down. I managed to recover. So this is the first time that any of us have ever had anything like this happen. But I didn't feel true relief until I saw him standing there, you know, smiling like an idiot.
That's right.
I'm fine.
Glad you're good.
Yeah.
Glad you're good.
Anything you walk away from is good. Glad you're good. Yeah. I've been walking.
My head's 100% fine. My neck doesn't hurt. No. That my freaking hip is killing me. And,
I'm
waiting for the
dynamic part.
My fork stopped. How'd that happen?
It didn't work.
Threads out. Both the threads out.
Well, did you see the front wheel? I saw a glance of it.
I was looking around the one side and I was like, it's not that bad. And then I saw the other side of the rim over.
I think it flipped a few times.
It said three.
Four. Oh. I don't know where I stood up. It was just, you know, it's just really loose. Shifted into the fourth a little early, like on purpose, at like $6,000 instead of 7,500. Bring it up in fourth, and it just stuck. And I had my steering damper cranked all the way up. It just started getting where I've never had an issue with the bike. It's as straight as an arrow. It started wobbling, and I went to go to the side because it looked just gnarly where I was at. And I backed off the throttle, and maybe that was the mistake. But anyway, it started just. I mean, it was.
It's like sand, second. Yeah. It's like it's you know, getting sand
and,
once you got to ride through. Let it
loose. Bit, you know, and just. So, you know, that bike was
so
pristine.
Oh, fuck yeah. The bike. I'm so glad you're right.
Yeah,
I don't know. Going to a tank slapper, low siding to a high side, and I went down the salt, and the bike frickin' flew up in the air and smashed a. You know, four or five or six times into the salt. And my face, the visor was torn off my shield, and I'm just staring up at the sky. I'm like, oh, Jesus Christ, you know. I was able to stand up, and I looked back, and my bike was way behind me down the salt. Walked down, picked the bike up, turned the fuel off, and it's all messed up. The front wheel is totally smashed. The whole rear end of the bike was smashed up. It was depressing, you know. And I had my right side was all like black and blue, and I couldn't stand up or sit down on my own. because it hurt so bad, this whole side of my body. But made a makeshift sling out of a tablecloth. I think an hour or so later, decided I better go to Salt Lake City, better go to the hospital, went to the emergency room and got checked out to make sure I didn't like explode a kidney and to see what was up with my arm.
So after last night, I mean, we were, you know, kind of cleaning up Tyler's bike, getting it back in the trailer. My bike was still in line for this morning. They shut the course down, so they let us leave bikes in position, which means this morning I came out and they do the record runs, and then I would have been, you know, six bikes back. I came out early, asked if I could, and walked out, felt the salt, looked at the course, and just to me, it just looked, you know, rolly. It looked rough, and the surface was wet. I mean, it was real similar to yesterday morning. You know, and kind of that combined with my brother having just wrecked and going off to the hospital and everything else, it's just everything just told me it's not safe.
Yeah. You can see the tire drags out. You can see how lumpy this is. And I mean, it's just wet. Yeah, I'm not doing this. Yeah, I mean, this is killing me, man. You know, like a year, bike's ready, I'm ready. My head's screwed up still yesterday because like seeing somebody, you see family, somebody you know crash is a whole different thing. And but the course is slow and I don't think it's safe. I mean, on a bike with like almost zero suspension, it's,
my brother having just wrecked and going off to the hospital and everything else, it's just everything just told me it's not safe. I mean, our bikes have a very similar geometry, riding position, which just offers you little control because you're laying down, you know, slick tires, very low profile and almost no suspension. So I decided to pull out a line and I left the van there for about 20 minutes before I actually moved it and fully committed. And it's just, you know, it's just heartbreaking and depressing. I think it was the right decision. First car that went out spun out. And as the day's gone on, there's been more of those. The speeds are just, you know, 30 to 50% under what they should be. Other riders are using the descriptive terms, you know, scary, dangerous, you know, sketchy as hell. I mean, you name it, it's bad conditions.
To be honest, we kind of heard last night, he said, you know what, let's just not run my bike. He said, he's fine with that. So I was like, well, I'll just run my bike.
Yeah.
My bike goes a lot faster than hers.
Yeah.
Like, it has a, like, 100 horsepower and a 4-inch tire.
Pretty much every one of us here, I think, is having this kind of conversation. Not in the back of the line, because they'd sat all day yesterday and never ran, but, you know, a lot of them might be a bit nervous. Their friend didn't go down also, and
this is killing me.
It completely fucked my head up, man. I was so nervous already yesterday, and then it's like Tyler's not the guy that goes down. You know, I'm a decent rider, he is better than me. You know, but we've been doing this a lot of years, and I've had nerves, but I've never been like nervous like I'm gonna pull out a line. I don't think I've ever said that.
Well, I gotta do it.
Today was a tough day. Maybe the toughest day of motorcycle racing I've had. You know, we were hoping for better conditions today. We showed up out there bright and early before dawn, excited to run, ready to go. It was a new course. We were over the moon. Got out there, and as soon as we got out of the truck, it was kind of greasy. And we waited and waited. The second car off spun badly, and word started coming down the line. It was greasy out there. We talked to an official, and he wasn't very optimistic. He said, well, this is as good as it's gonna get. And I'm like, well, shit. So we watched a few guys run. They were spinning and wobbling all over the place. Speed Demon pulled out at the 1 mile. That really kind of shook my confidence when they pulled out. My mind started to change. You know, I started to talk to my crew a little bit, my wife Lori and Herb, Bill, my crew chief, and they were kind of all telling me maybe today, maybe it's not going to happen, and maybe we just got to accept that we're not going to do it. I thought about running just for fun, but I didn't build that bike to run just for fun. I built that thing to break a record, and it was obvious we didn't have the traction or the salt to get out there and break a record. I mean, at the end of the day, it was the ultimate hard decision I've ever had to make, but we called it a day. So we went back to the pits and cracked a beer at, I don't even know, 10:30 in the morning, and nursed our wounds and started packing up and cleaning up. And I'm still kind of, it's still settling in. I still can't believe that's it. Obviously, that's a big part of my decision today was not to put it on anybody, but seeing Tyler go down, I think you I don't want to steal your, you said it best when you said it's like watching Superman fall, like holy shit. Like Tyler went out, he's so confident and so calm and collected. And to hear he went down, Greg and I were in the truck and you just couldn't believe it. And then he was actually kind of hurt and the bike was trashed. And that was a big confidence shaker. And he said my worst kind of situation where he said that the course felt good. He was kind of getting into it. The course was hard and suddenly kind of changed. And within a second, he was in a tank slapper and cartwheeling down the track. Yeah, he sent me a text this morning that kind of said, you know, I told him, oh, dude, I think I'm going to pull out. And he sent me a nice text that just said, you know, don't sweat it. And that even he learned that, you know, you think you can control these situations and sometimes you just can't. So anyway, I take that to heart and I'm trying not to feel too bad about quitting, but I'm not quitting. I just didn't run today. I'm not quitting, we'll be back next year. I just didn't run today. Yeah, his accent certainly shook me. Blender has been fantastic. Bit of a little bobble right there. Turns out we were out of fuel. That's how much we've been using the blender as we ran through a tank of gas this week. I'm happy there's some other Canadians out there that also had a two-stroke blender. So Canada represent with the two-stroke blender and the margaritas. Maybe it's our new, you know, we gotta get rid of the Caesar and get the margarita for our national drink or whatever, right? No, the blender ran great all week. We made lots of margaritas. And we're gonna make lots more tonight. It's gonna be great. Party at Bonneville. I always have a good time at Bonneville.
Here we are in the swamp lands of Nevada.
Ah,
I think I'm rich because it was a little boggy. I had to ease on the throttle, which isn't ideal, you know, for getting to my power band, but I ran like 6,900 RPM, which is below my power band. I went into the two at 132 and out of the three at 132. So I think I should be right in there on that GPS. So it should be, I think we just go to get my slip and go to impound because the record's only 126.
Yeah.
And I think I'm going to jet down one. I mean, it is. Awesome.
Can you jet down in there?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, it was. I had to feather that like back out on and forth. I had to back off and kind of bring it up slow. Which I know even from the dyno, just that throttle control, that's. It was just not ideal. But anyway, I think I'm rich, and I think if I jet a little leaner, I think I'll pick up a few miles on it. It was great. I felt like I was going slow one time ago. I'm doing 128 or something. And, it took a little while to pull up for fourth. Like I said, it was definitely on the 2 to 3. It was by far better than the 1 to 2. But I think it's, I think I'm just rich.
That's good that it.
I expected to be rich coming in. I thought I might bog down. My first run 2018, I only pulled 6,500 RPM or something. And then I dropped one jet size, and I think I picked up 5 miles an hour.
Felt good.
Yeah, operated straight. That was my run from last year.
That's good. That's what we want to hear.
Better. Couldn't be any better. You said it.
So,
we did.
That was redemption for all the time in the garage.
Yeah,
you know?
Fuck yeah.
First run felt great. Course is great. I think so. Is it over 126 and a half? My GPS said 132.
131.
Perfect. Woo. Start.
713.
Awesome, that's great. I went into the 2 at 132 on my little GPS and came out at 132, so I was hoping it was 131. I better be, if I come over and it's 125, I'm going to be freaking pissed.
One for impound and two for you.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
See you again. So mile 2, thank you. Mile 2, 126 and a half. 2 and a quarter, 131. That's a nice tick up, you know, when I got into the power band. Then 131.2 at the 2 and a quarter, 131.7 at the 3. So I came into the 2 5 miles under. So I've got, it was rich too. So I got to drop a jet and I can pick up a few miles an hour, I think. So I was really excited last year to get one run. I wanted to go right into impound. Got to 3/4 of a mile down the course, wrecked, went to the hospital, surgery, months of dealing with all that stuff. So it's a big deal to get back out here this year. And I'm super stoked because my best case scenario was to do one run, go right in impound, and that's exactly what happened. It performed, it was actually running rich, which is fine. So I'll be able to go a little faster, but I did 132.7 on a 126.455 or so record. So I'm pretty stoked on that. And I know there's more in there. I think I can pull at least for sure 3 or 4 more miles an hour out of it and try and get that record up. So I feel great. It makes all the work worthwhile when I get the results out of it.
Customs on your record backup.
Yep, that'll do it. 126 and a half was the record for Tyler. The record he was running on. Yesterday's 131.713 and today's 129.293 averages out to about a 130 and a half or thereabouts. And that's 4 miles an hour on yesterday's old record. So congratulations to Tyler Malinky. 750.
Yeah, 128 at the two, 129.2 at the two and a quarter, and almost dead nuts to the three.
So it just held.
Yeah. With a lower gearing, I would expect that. Get to the top speed. That's top speed for the RPM I could pull based on being too rich and that gearing.
Yeah, yeah.
Because that's geared for 136 and 129, but I was running 7 grand instead of 72 or 7250. So that's like easily a few more horsepower, and that was a couple hundred RPM. So same sprocket, adjust the chain, drop one main jet, go running.
Yeah. 133.
Go in and get the record certification.
Which shouldn't take long.
It should take 5 minutes, hopefully. The engine being sealed. First day. Did a nice clean run. Ran, I think it was 131.7 on that 126 record. Did a little jetting, tuning, adjusted my rear chain, ran again in the morning, and ran, I think I ran like 129 or something. Wasn't a great run, but it was pretty good. And got that record at 130.508, I think it is. So that's a new record. Did a couple more runs I want to get this record. I really wanted to get to like 135, but I just wasn't there. I was maxing the bike out, running real consistent, like 131 from, you know, for 2 miles straight. Just holding that speed, wasn't pulling the last few hundred RPM I wanted to get. So we ended up re-tacking for fuel class. I did a class change where for that, all I had to do was switch out to a fuel petcock that's got a tether here. You turn the petcock on like normally, it has a solid lock with a pin. And then to shut the petcock off, the only way is to use the lever on the bars. So you could be riding if you have a problem, you catch on fire or think you're gonna catch on fire, you have a fuel leak, you can stay in control of the machine, kill your fuel for safety. So I was re-inspected for that, and that record from 2002, and it's only, it was 121 and change. So my goal was to get it over 130. I ran on it yesterday late in the day. It was real hot, maybe 80 degrees or so. It was running real good through the two and a quarter. I think I was basically at 130 and would normally pick up from there. And I was losing some RPMs the last half mile, last few hundred RPM. Ran, I think it was 127.8, which is okay. You know, I wasn't exactly happy about it. I was kind of pissy about it. But we went through the bike. The plugs looked pretty lean. So jetted a little bit richer, really went through the carbs, tuned them up. Went over the whole bike, but always really feel all the hardware, make sure there's nothing loose, nothing's cracked, there's not something that'd be a safety issue. And got the bike running real nice. Ran this morning. I really had to gas it off the line, which is not normal, where I had to kind of feather the clutch, really rev it up to get going. It almost fell on its face, but then it took off. But I couldn't pull. I basically did 125. Otherwise, it was a really solid run. Technique was good. Shifts were good. All that is just that's what it would do. And I won't know until I pull the engine, pull the head. But I'm pretty sure I must have maybe either slightly bent a valve or more likely, because I'm only running 6 or 7 miles slower than peak, that I might have just like nicked a valve. I might have caught the edge of a valve pocket from valve float or a little over rev. So I'll find that out when I get home. I'll pull the engine out, pull the head off, inspect it. Clearance of pistons is necessary so it doesn't happen again. And that's how you learn. That's exactly racing. But I've got two records this week. Bumped one of my own up, took another record and bumped it over 5 miles an hour. And it's good because there's more there for this bike, for this engine, for those records. And all in all, it was a great week.
Come on, you want to eat those?
I do want to eat those.
Take them. Here, all right. We're paying for them.
some COVID cash.
Yum, yum.
I texted him, yum, 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 with a photo. Those look good. What is it? It's like a little cheesy.
It's like,
oh, prosciutto something, with mozzarella.
Something
prosciutto with mozzarella.
What's that?
It's a beer, huh?
Yes. Yeah, it's great. It's going over really well on the internet.
Dinner.
Yeah, it was interesting when, you know, I was talking with Tyler and when he said he was coming to race, you know, originally I said, well, you know, like maybe I'll come. And I guess he was, the entire time, he was thinking I was coming to race and I just was gonna come out and support. I kind of figured like, hey, I'll do like a 10-day camping trip and help crew and everything else. But then as the week went on, of course, I started thinking, well, my bike is so ready and maybe, you know, maybe I should just go. And, you know, it kind of snowballed quickly where, you know, I started getting everything together. But I did not make up my mind until I did my dyno session and everything was just 100%, and I just said, well, you know, hell with it, I'm going. Yeah, I mean, that definitely affected how you thought coming out this year. I mean, I actually didn't even pre-register because I wanted to see the salt with my own eyes before I was, I mean, I would have driven 1,800 miles and left my bike in the truck if I didn't feel it was safe to run. We got onto the salt and I saw how hard it was and dry and, I mean, there was no question I was racing. But even that first run, I mean, on top of all the other things in your head and the fact that I haven't ridden this bike in a year and, you know, just all these things. I mean, of course you're thinking, you know, my brother wrecked last year. You know, there's a real weight to it. You know, you know it's dangerous. You know, go to start the bike and, you know, I'm just kind of like in a hurry. I'm trying to slow myself down, but again, it's just all nerves and adrenaline. Get up to the line and, you know, they clear me to go. And I go a couple feet, stall out past the line. So of course then it's like, give me the kicker back, start the bike back up. You know, so at this point I'm breathing heavy, my visor's fogging up, they go again. So, you know, I take off, make sure obviously I don't do the same thing again, a little more throttle. You know, and just go down track and focus on my shifts. And, you know, after that, it was fine. It was a clean run. But again, first time on the salt for this 2 years since I'd raced on the salt. Kill the motor after the 3 mile pull off, and you know, I'm just trying to rip and get my gear off because at that point I'm just, you know, I'm pouring sweat. It's I think 45, 50 degrees out when I ran, and I'm just soaked. You know, so that was the first run. Every run after that just got, you know, I'm standing at the line joking around, like I'm calm, I'm ready, I know the bike's right. So it just, you know, gets easier every run. So I did 6 runs total. Just some, you know, some minor things. Early on, I decided I wasn't quite pulling the gearing I wanted, so I added a tooth to the rear, you know, which has consistently raised my speeds. And at that point, you know, I was in the 129 range, and the record I'm running for is 130.73. So it's close, but I mean, you got to understand, that's that mile and a half an hour out here is huge. I mean, that record has been standing for 9 years now, and it's tall. It's tall for a Triumph.
Oh, see here. Oh, it's so damn close. Right, I'm over there. 130, man, you're but right, I broke my tachometer.
Really?
It said I did this all by feel. Wow. Yeah, it said I was doing 5,500 RPMs, which I wasn't. I knew I wasn't. Right. So.
You got that buck 30 number.
Yeah, right, yeah, a little bit faster at the quarter, but then again, this is where my tachometer broke, because 2.5 and I hit that big ditch.
So I broke 130 on the salt, which is like, I mean, huge. That's like such a personal goal. But all those runs, they were all within plus or minus 0.5 miles per hour. I mean, I have a 130 mile an hour bike on the salt. It's 136 plus on concrete, but I mean, it just shows you the altitude, the traction. Even with the longer course here, even having 3 miles, man, it's hard, you know? It's a difficult racing environment. Well, basically, I did my
I did my last run here this morning, and I'd pretty much already decided, like, you know, I'm gonna go out, and if I have a clean run and I give it all it can, that would most likely be it. So I went out this morning and again ran right about 130, and it's so close to the record, but you know, I could probably go do this 10 more times and it's just beating me up physically. It's beating the bike up and it's just not there. It's so close, but you know, again, out here you have to make it to qualify. Then you have to back it up. They take the average. So it's just the chances of me getting it, I just do not feel it's there. That last run was textbook perfect. The bike was perfect. The course was great. The wind was dead. And it's just not there. It is probably whiskey time, yeah.
So real sad that at Speed Week, I think it was on the last day, Ralph Hudson crashed his bike on shutdown after backing up a record. I think I guess there's decent crosswinds, and he lost control of his bike, came off at over 250 miles an hour. He was life flighted to Salt Lake and ended up not making it. A few weeks later, he passed because of that. And it's a big loss for everyone here and for everyone. He was an awesome guy, super nice. Anyone who knew him will say the same. He's just such a great guy, creative and fast. He's the fastest motorcyclist in the world. He ran in Bolivia a couple times. There was an organized land speed meet there for some of the fastest guys in the world. Salt flat Bolivia at 12,000 foot elevation, super smooth and dry, but really high elevation, which is a challenge. And he set a two-way average of 299, I think, and change. I think his top one-way speed, I think, was 304. I might be wrong on that, but basically, I mean, fast, super fast. So he set that record here at Speed Week, but ended up dying because of it. But you know, what can you do? You know, that's life. But there was a great memorial here the other morning where a bunch of racers gathered out on the salt before sunrise. Talked about Ralph, had a little candle vigil, and we all watched the sunrise. Some people shared some words, and it was super touching, you know.
I'm really glad that you all could make it. Sunrise was a really important time for Ironwood Racing, because we all know that when we get to watch the sunrise on the salt, it means that we've qualified for a record, which is what we all want to do here. And I'm really grateful that I got to watch so many sunrises with Ralph. May those who mourn be blessed with the comfort of the love we've shared and continue to share. May we face each new day with the hope and the certainty that nothing can destroy the good that has been given. May the memories unfold us as prayers for life and inspire us. May the first breath of each morning begin life again. May the sweet light of change and possibility illuminate the darkness. May their love fill the silence. May the memories of those who have passed become joyful, our days enriched by the friendships, and our lives enriched by their love.
You all have a cup, right? See this cup? I don't see any that look like my cup.
Mine does.
No, it's different.
I have one, it's right here, he's holding it.
Yes, it's different. But it's how you look at it. And you know, as important as the cup is, it's nothing. It's a shell. Because what's important is what's inside the cup, you see. Some of you got coffee, some of you got tea, some of you got Pepsi. What you put in the cup is what you share with others, what you pour out. Okay? Those of you that know me know my cup's pretty much full of shit. And I say that because I'm who I am for opportunities like this, okay? My cup looks bitter, and sometimes it's not fitting, but you'll notice that there's a sweetness inside of it. Stacy did, Ralph did. So what Ralph taught me, if you've never felt this, I swear, I thought my Harley's been on a trailer for 7 years because I can't stop this. Jumping an intersection at 85 miles an hour with the front wheel in the air, and my inner voice said, if you do it again, I was going to set up a camera. I'll throw you to the ground. So I put it on a trailer. We might race it, we don't know. But listen to what's inside. Know what's in your cup. Okay. Ralph, he lived and he filled these cups. You see, and once you share what's in the cup, it goes in to someone else. See, Ralph, he's moved on somewhere else, but he poured something inside of each of us. So he's still here. And he'll live on forever through each of us.
Can you feel it?
A romancer. I'm a Capricorn, she's a Cancer.
What?
I just greased them.
No, it's not sticking. I'm a little damp.
That's all I got. Sorry.
You had one job.
One job to do, and I screwed it up.
He's in the middle of a solo, dude.
I am Kyle from Lowbrow Customs, and I'm here on Bonneville Salt Flats 2019 Speed Week.
Yeah, I heard Kyle selling his bike. He said hit him up on Instagram, DM him. $3,200, race ready.
Sun comes at you from every direction, and I like speed.
Hey, take it easy.
here it feels normal still. Hey. Oh, thank you.
Thanks, man.
Walter. This is New Jersey, guys.
Yeah, for 2021, lots of plans. I actually had planned on building a new dual engine bike for 2020. I've got my wife and my daughters I love to spend time with, and other interests like riding mountain bikes and this and that. So I decided, oh, I'll just take a little more time. And then with COVID hitting and all that stuff, it really changed the race season anyway. So for 2021, plan to have my new dual engine, 1950 Triumph. Been working on the chassis design with Dowie from Dutch Engineering since December of last year, so 10 months in, and fully CAD modeled the entire bike. We're actually just working on getting all the jigs made for building the frame, like right now, basically as soon as we get home, with Tim of Fiorucci Fabrication. He's gonna be building the frame for me. And really excited about that bike because this bike's essentially a test bed for that. Same wheel, front and rear, same front end, a lot of similarities. It's gonna be a dual engine bike with a 3-inch longer wheelbase, and it's basically a really small dual engine bike that should be, you know, 120, 130 horsepower on gas. And hopefully I'll come out here next year with a new bike, tuned, ready to go and slay some records. And this bike, I'll know more once I pull the head off, but at this point what I'm thinking is get this thing tuned up, potentially try a different head or a carburetor setup, get a little more power out of it, bring it out with the intentions of bumping records. But we're thinking now it's hard mentally and physically to run two bikes at one event. I've never done it. So maybe get some of our crew getting the rookie runs done on this bike and competing on some records. So we've got big plans. My wife and daughters are going to come out for Speed Week, as well as my brother, his wife, and my nephews, and all of our friends and crew. And we've got big plans. I think everyone's planning after being stuck at home mostly for 2020. It should be a really big year, and hoping to come out and set records. That's always a plan, but should be a good year. See you out there. And anyone, you guys and gals, you want to make it to Bonneville, don't say it's a bucket list thing. Get your butt out here, drive out, whatever. You can camp at the bend in the road for free. It costs, I don't even know, barely anything. You can come and spectate. You can be pop by our pit, say hello, watch people run, see the fastest cars and bikes in the world. Have a freaking great time. Or better yet, you know, buy the $10 SCTA rule book, check out the class records and the rules. Get yourself a bike together. You can start easy and cheap and get out here and, you know, race. Have some fun.